Good morning, everybody. So I had actually put together a presentation that I completely changed just yesterday. Because first I read Richard's contribution to the electricity newspaper. So what I wanted to talk about originally was what you find actually in the newspaper, in the electricity newspaper. It's about top-down and bottom-up cities. And that's the article we did with Anthony Townsend. I realized that Adam was going to talk about it, and you know, Richard was going to talk about Sonda. So I changed it completely yesterday, and I wanted to talk to you today, really about, yes, we all agree that Songdo and similar examples are not the good example of smart cities. And you know, they don't have that complexity that Richard was talking about before. But then how do we move forward? And you know, what is really there to last? Because something is happening, that's what we're discussing here today. So let's look at those dimensions. And so if this is not the model, what are the things that will last? And I think there's two components. One is how this technology that radically changed our lives. Nothing in what we do today, in the way we live, we work, we meet people, we mate, everything is different than it was like 15, 20 years ago. So how this technology is actually changing design, the design of our cities, our buildings, our objects, and how that has then an impact on people. And then the other thing is more Mumfordian. If you think about Lewis Mumford, he would have said how actually this technology is changing people, is changing all of us, and then design our cities will change as a consequence. So that is actually what I wanted to briefly go through with you in the next few minutes. And I usually start with a metaphor, with an analogy to explain what is happening today. You know, the analogy is Formula One. 10, 15 years ago, if you wanted to win a Formula One race, you needed a good car and a good driver. You needed actually physical stuff. Today, if you want to win a Formula One race, you also need something like this. A system made of thousands and thousands of sensors onto the car, collecting information in real time, sending it to those computers where they are analyzed, they are processed, and decisions are made in real time. In other terms, that's what engineers call real-time control systems, which are basically made of two components, a sensing component and an actuating component. And sensing and actuating really is the basis of life. It's, you know, when we see each other, we sense each other, we shake hands, collect information from each other, and then respond to that information. Now, the amazing thing, I believe, that we heard about yesterday and today is that our cities are starting to behave like that Formula One racing car. Our cities have been covered with layers and layers of technology, of sensors, of networks, and because of that, the way we can understand them, the way we can design them, and ultimately live in them, is changing. Almost as if every atom out there were becoming both a sensor and an actuator. Well, you might say, all of this is fine, but what are the profound consequences of this? And you know, is this going to lead to experiments like Songdo and similar, or to other things? And I think there was an interesting exhibition at MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art, a few months ago. We were part of it last year, actually. The title was Talk to Me. And the idea is that all of these technologies actually allow our cities, our environment, to respond to us in a more dynamic way, almost to talk to us. It's almost like the old dream of Michelangelo. When he sculpted Moses, he saw the story goes, he took a hammer, he threw the hammer at Moses and shouted, "Perché non parli? Why don't you speak?" And today, for the first time, our cities, our buildings, our homes, our objects are starting to speak back to us. And I think if we start from here, then we can understand how smart city, that's a terrible name, we like to call it more sensible city, can actually bring about that complexity that Richard was talking about. And I'll briefly go through some examples. I think it's a field that's really, it's still tentative. It's what's happening today. It's just an exploration. I want to share with you some exploration, both on this level, technology, change in design, and having an impact on people, and later, technology, people, and design. Now, on this side, how then technology can allow us to make design that are more responsive. It's the old dream that you find also in the Baroque times. You know, when you look at the beautiful Baroque masterpieces, they're trying to look alive. They'll try to capture movement, but there's actually a tragedy there. They're set in stone, they're set in bricks, you know, they cannot move. They look alive, but they're dead. Today, we can do something that's more alive. That's a project we've been involved with. It's in Zaragoza, Spain, at the World Expo, just before Shanghai. And the mayor came to us with a simple question. You know, water has been a great ingredient of planning architecture for centuries. How can we use water today in a different way? And you know, if you, one of the ideas that came up at MIT was, imagine you have a pipe, like you see here, and that pipe has many solenoid valves opening and closing. Then you create all, can create almost like a living water wall where you can write, show images, text, pictures. You approach it, it opens up to let you in. So then that led to the design of the building at the entrance of the expo. We call it the Digital Water Pavilion. The whole building is made of water. There's no doors or windows, but when you approach it, actually the building opens up to let you in. And then when you're inside, all the walls expand and shrink based on how many people you have there. The roof is also covered with a thin layer of water. And then, you know, if there's too much wind, you can lower the roof to minimize splashing. Or at the end of the day, you can actually close the building and the whole architecture disappears. Hopefully without anybody underneath. There's sensors for that as well. And here you can see the building before the opening. You see this guy was with a trolley stopping by. He stopped there just for 15 minutes, trying to figure out what the hell was going on there. This was, you know, the physical pixels made of water plus projections on the top of that. This was myself trying not to get wet. And here I wanted to share with you another interesting aspect of technology. Actually, one night, all of the computers that control the building is made of thousands of sensors and so on, it's very easy to interact with. You don't see that, you know, people from 5 year age to 95 year age can interact with it, but all those computers stop working so that the building would keep on doing its own crazy things, but stop responding to people. So the sensors that detect when people approach stop working. And that night we were terrified because, you know, we wouldn't know what would happen, but actually that night was one of the most fun nights ever, with thousands of kids from all of Saragossa coming to the building to play a different game like this. And for us, that was an interesting thing because as architects, as engineers, we always think we know how people will behave in our spaces, like, you know, Corbusier thought about in the Ville Radieuse, as we saw before. But actually reality, especially human reality, and especially when things become, interaction between people and the city becomes more dynamic, then is always a surprise. Now, all of this, this idea of technology actually allowing to have more responsive designs, designs with which we can engage more in this living, responsive way, can apply to many other things. I'll go briefly, you know, can apply to bus stops that can give you real-time information. Just very simply, you just touch, it tells you where to go. Think about how difficult it is in London here, when you have like five or different bus routes at every bus stop. Just it takes you 5 minutes to understand, you know, where is the right one. And you know, how, you know, this allows you to give back this information into the city. The same thing, that's a project that we presented at the design fair in Milan this year about kitchen and cooking and how that changed the dimension. I'll go briefly, or, you know, really how everything is a mirror that allows you to see yourself in front and back, but how this technology changes, can change design, and hence our interaction with the environment. But very briefly, what I find most exciting is actually how technology is changing our life, and that then has an impact on design of our cities. And briefly, an example from MIT. If you look at this, it's our campus, almost like a small city. You see Boston, MIT, Harvard, don't bother. And then, you know, what happened is that it was one of the first campuses where the whole place was covered with Wi-Fi. And then people used to work, as you see on the left here, and now they're working more as you see on the right, a big change. Now, the interesting thing, I mean, that's a bit exaggerated. I found the most boring computer room I could find to the left, and, you know, and a nice sunny day to the right. It's probably not like this today with snow and freezing and gale on campus. But then what you can do is use actually the same network from MIT to understand this transformation. You can get all this information from the Wi-Fi to see how people live and move on campus. And you know, look at this disaggregated information. You see how much, when and where people work. You see Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday till Sunday. Look at that, that's the aggregated all campus at the top. You see, you know, just a few people are the lucky few working 9 to 5. Most people still work quite late, till 10, 11, but still in the middle of the night, a lot of activity. And that repeats on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. not Friday, when activity actually slips away in the afternoon, as you see. Saturday and Sunday, still quite normal working days, with something interesting on Sunday night. You see it there, average, it happens all the time around 9 p.m. And that's actually when you realize, shit, tomorrow is Monday again, and you go back to work. So if you look at that, and if you look at this and analyze all these things, you get interesting mathematical analysis that tells you really how work is changing. And you see actually how people work in different ways over the whole campus in combining different usage that were not what they were before. It was not Corbusier's city, where you got different things for different activities, but activities are starting to overlap. And, you know, we are exploring this in the case of a new city we are designing in Mexico. Here we're looking at how public spaces can become places where you also work, where actually the courtyards, the beautiful Mexican courtyards, can become extensions of the office, traditional courtyards or new courtyards, where you can actually work outdoors most of the year. How this can become also a project on the Himalayas, where you can stay longer and again make your home in your office up there in a beautiful setting, or all the way to the furniture. This is a project that will be unveiled at the design fair in Milan this year. It's about, you know, simple thing. How can you actually, because we all go home and have an iPad, that's a, how can that change the accessories we need to have in our house, in our home, in order, in a very simple way, just to take into account these changes in the way we live. And that is really what I wanted to finish with. That's an example of something we built in Milan in Piazza della Scala. It's really a new space, it's the extension of the Trussardi Fashion House, but that space was thought as an extension of the Fashion House, yes, a place you can have a coffee, or a place where you can go meet your friend and do work, something you couldn't do a few years ago just because you were chained to a desk, you were chained to a computer, and you didn't have the flexibility that we have today. And you know, and then it becomes this almost, you know, an open urban living room. And I wanted to finish with these images because I think that is what I find most exciting about these technologies, that when technology is everywhere, there's almost like a paradox. And the paradox is you can finally forget about it. And when you forget about it, you can then go back to look at things we really are passionate about in our cities, in our buildings. And that's about people, it's about the social quality of the spaces and the environmental quality of our environment. Thank you.